Welcome to Toy Train Review Number 3. We have a great show for you. We are going to take you to Lionel for the opening of their new showroom layout and visitor center. Then to Strasburg, Pennsylvania for a visit with Tom Groff at the Choo Choo Barn. We'll meet Bob Weaver, the man behind Weaver Models, and we'll also visit three layouts, 2O gauge and 1 American Flyer S gauge. We have a lot to cover, so let's get started. Our first story takes us to Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, and the home of Carl Burkhart.
Carl Burkhart's Lionel post-war layout is small, but it packs a lot of action. The layout measures 11 feet by 8 feet and is located downstairs in the study of Burkhart's ranch-style home.
I can run a total of 3 trains plus a trolley, but I have a choice of 7 trains to run any 3 of. In other words, on my outside track, which is primarily a passenger track, I have a choice of 3 passenger trains. I have 2 freights on the second track. I've run either one of them. And normally, I have 2 freights on the third track, but right now I'm running a passenger and a freight in there. So of the 7 trains, we can run 3 at any one time.
There are 4 transformers. 2 Lionel ZWs power the trains, and 2 Zs power the lights and accessories. All the curves are standard O gauge, and the wiring is not color-coded.
I imagine if another train collector got under my layout and looked at my wiring, he'd probably shudder. But I know what's under there, I know how I did it, and it's worked for 8 years, so I'm happy.
Burkhart grew up in Brooklyn, and in 1950, a great thing happened. Carl's dad, Henry, became the official Lionel train salesman at the FAO Schwartz toy store located just over the Hudson River in New York City.
Each year he had the opportunity to get some display items after the holidays and things like that at very excellent prices. So our post-war Lionel train layout developed very rapidly.
A Lionel train layout became a holiday tradition for the Burkhart family.
On Thanksgiving Day, we would lay plywood on our living room floor and build a train layout. And when the track and wiring was completed, we'd put a huge Christmas tree in the middle of the layout. Normally, we'd just about get finished in time for Christmas Eve. The trains would stay in place on the living room floor through the Christmas holidays, through January and February. The tree would come down in the middle of January, but the trains would stay until probably mid-March.
Henry enjoyed the layouts as much as Carl did, and years later, with his health failing, Henry moved in with Carl and his wife, Barb.
So in his last year of life, which he spent with us, he wanted to see a train layout. We built a smaller version train layout on our living room floor, which he enjoyed on his last Christmas. That train layout stayed on our living room floor for 4 years until I created this. This is a sort of a memorial, I guess you could say, to my childhood Christmas train layouts.
And the layout was a memorial to his dad, too.
He loved it. He sat by it day after day, admiring it. Brought back a lot of memories for him, and it brought back a lot of memories for me.
Burkhart has always been fond of the Lionel SP-styled caboose. Lionel made 2 versions, an inexpensive, unadorned version and a fully equipped version, which featured 2 ladders, 2 operating couplers, a chimney, toolboxes, windows, and illumination. Carl bought both and took the parts off the better version and installed them on the cheaper version.
Basically, cheapy cabooses that have been fully trimmed with toolbox frames, ladders, chimneys, windows, lights, the whole 9 yards.
The result, a unique backdrop, 33 Lionel SP-style cabooses, all wired, all fully equipped, and all one of a kind. For Christmas 1950, Carl wanted a 622 Santa Fe switcher. In 1950, Lionel trains were scarce, and a 622 switcher couldn't be found in stock anywhere. Larry Cowan, Joshua Lionel Cowan's son, was a regular customer at FAO Schwartz.
Apparently he was a customer there, and he always checked with Dad to see how Lionel train sales were going and things, and Dad mentioned to him of our hunt for a 622 that we couldn't seem to find to buy, and several hours later, Dad received the 622 by messenger that supposedly was the 622 off the Lionel showroom layout. I have no way of proving that, but I was given the engine as for Christmas in 1950, and I was very flattered with the story, and it certainly made me happy as a 13-year-old. It was Dad's goal all his life to be able to build an Irvington that was powered, that would go around the Lionel curve. He never succeeded, although he tried.
Years later, Carl did. By trimming a little flashing off the window brackets, Carl was able to install a 2023 Lionel Elko motor in trucks.
The one truck is the power truck, power geared truck, and the other truck is the nose truck off the dummy unit, but with the collector rollers added to that truck. Because on the Alco, the collector rollers are always on the rear truck of the locomotive. One of my special treats was in the fall of 1951. I visited Schwartz to see my dad on a Saturday, and the Lionel demonstrator, who was hired just to run the Lionel train layout, was sick.
Carl was asked if he would mind standing in for the absent Lionel demonstrator. Carl did not mind at all.
And at the end of the day, the vice president of the Star, I believe his name was Strobel, Mr. Strobel, wanted to see me. So at the end of the day, Dad took me up to his office. And mind you, this is 1951. Mr. Strobel gave me a $5 bill and shook my hand and thanked me for my efforts. And to me, running Lionel trains all day, I didn't need to be paid to do that, but it was certainly a highlight for me. I don't have the $5 bill anymore, but I had a little yellow button that said I was a train demonstrator, and I saved that till this time.
Carl operates the trains for his own enjoyment at least every other day. Sometimes he is content to just sit in the darkened room. The train's at rest, the only illumination coming from the small lights on the layout. It is during these quiet moments that the memories begin. We have heard many times that toy trains are just products to be manufactured and sold like any other product. We don't think so, and either does Carl Burkhardt.
Seven-year-old Terry Johnson has been building train layouts since he was a kid. He has built N-gauge layouts, HO gauge, and in November of 1990, he decided to build a Lionel layout.
Well, with the HO layout, the operation of it is something that I wanted to do, and with Lionel, I just wanted to be able to run trains and have a good time and see the bells and whistles and lights and smell the smoke and the ozone and get dirty and hear the bang of the wheels on the rails.
The layout is U-shaped and is built along four walls of the 18 by 21 foot room. A bridge, which Johnson crafted from 1x4s, Tinker Toy parts, and a gear motor, lifts to allow entrance, then lowers to provide an uninterrupted path for the two main lines. An electrical interlock stops the trains if the bridge is in the up position.
Right now I have three loops, and the top two are connected to each other, so I can run any train on any of those two loops anywhere on the track that I want. At this point in time, I can only run three trains at once, but it's wired for blocks right now, and when the financial situation allows, I'll be buying some relays, and I can run up to probably seven trains at one time.
The layout is still being built, and eventually Terry will add more scenery and buildings. But it's nice just the way it is now, kind of sparse and vacant, a refreshing change from layouts where every square inch is covered with something.
Well, as you can see, I've got a long way to go as far as scenery. I'd like to do a little bit more scenery on the Lionel, but not so much as the HO. We'll buy a lot more Plasticville because that's what the kid would have had in the 50s, and that's what I want to have now.
One area that is finished is the mountain, which rises 6 feet, 4 inches from the floor. Its deep river gorge is spanned by an impressive 40-inch long trestle bridge, which Terry hand-built by cutting 1x4 pine into narrow strips.
I sell dental supplies, so I have access to dental plaster and stone, so I built the mountain out of a web of autoclave tape, which is like masking tape, and newspapers wet down with water, and some plaster of Paris and some dental stone and dental plaster.
Terry has eclectic tastes when it comes to buying trains. He operates pre-war, post-war, and modern Lionel, along with Williams and Marks.
My favorite train is the next one I'm going to buy.
There is also a nice mix of accessories. A scratch-built turntable awaits a roundhouse, which is currently in production. Seven-year-old Christopher Johnson's favorite is the unit action train, featuring a long line of Lionel giraffe cars.
My seven-year-old thinks that having a basement full of trains is normal.
The layout is powered by Lionel ZW and KW transformers. A Lionel 1033 powers the yard. There are 12 blocks for the main lines, and each siding is also blocked. Several small transformers power the lights and send constant voltage to the switch machines. The track is Gargrave's Phantom Third Rail, combined with Lionel 072 switches. The upper loop has 072 curves, the middle 054, and the lower loop 027-inch curves.
I wanted to put the Lionel layout at about eye height, and my eye height is probably around 5 feet 5 inches or 5'7". And I wanted the highest rail to be that high so you could view it and look like you were really at the rail head when you were looking at it. And then we went down from there, so it's about 40 inches at one height and 65, so something like that at the other height.
Johnson's goal is to make a layout reminiscent of those built during the boom times of toy trains.
I have all three of them because I'm using the Lionel layout a little bit like a museum in that I want to show a little bit of everything that the Lionel had, or at least a sampling of it, so people can, non-railroaders or non-model railroaders can kind of come in and see what a kid in the 50s would have had.
Terry thinks the future for toy trains is bright.
Lionel's doing very good. I'm happy to see that Mr. Coon's in the helm and doing a good job with the company, and I plan on collecting a lot more because I just started and I've got a lot of display tracks that I need to have trains set on.
Oh yes, Terry collects hats too.
Okay, I've been collecting Mark's trains for ever since I was a child. I think the most unique and unusual train that Mark's ever made, as far as I was concerned, is the one that I received when I was 3 years old, when I was a child, was the Markstronic Switcher, also known as the train with the brain. And they sold for approximately $6 to $8 in 1959. My set still has the original instructions on how to change the battery and the operation of it. The set consisted of a diesel industrial switcher, two gondolas, a red one and a yellow one. It also came with six barrels and a flagman. And the train was designed to automatically spot the cars on the sidetracks and load a barrel one at a time and then pick the cars back up without doing anything to the train. It was all automatic. So the reason they called the train with the brain. It's a hard set to find, especially in mint condition like mine is. There's nothing broken on it. It's all complete.
Special time. Clint Eastwood, Pale Rider. Followed by Eyewitness News after the movie. This is Eyewitness News with John Drury and Diane Burns, Steve Deschler with weather, Jim Rose on sports, and the Eyewitness News team.
John Drury is a toy train collector. He also is news anchor for ABC in Chicago.
Tom McComas called and asked me if I'd narrate a piece for Toy Train Review. I've been a Toy Train buff since I was a little kid, and Tom is doing such a great job with Toy Train Review that I'm happy to help out. My parents gave me my first train when I was 8 years old. It was an inexpensive sheet metal American Flyer Zephyr. It sold for $5. It was during the Depression, and $5 in those days was a lot of money. But my parents got it for me for Christmas, and I was thrilled. Since then, I've bought lots of trains, but I've never been able to find that sheet metal Zephyr, and I'm still looking. It's a coincidence that Tom asked me to narrate a story about Weaver models because I just purchased a Weaver. It's gorgeous. So I'm as eager as you are to find out about the history of Weaver models. Let's get started. Weaver models is another new name which popped up on the toy train horizon in the mid-80s. A division of Quality Craft Products, Weaver Models experienced rapid growth during those boom times. Bob Weaver owns and operates Quality Craft. Bob received a set of Lionel trains before his first birthday and has been playing with trains, either model or toy, ever since. He currently operates a scale, O-gauge, 34 by 60 foot layout in the basement of his Northumberland, Pennsylvania home. Weaver started making HO woodcar kits under the Quality Craft name in 1965. In 1980, he made his first O-gauge car, a scale two-bay coal car. He asked his friend Hal Karstens, publisher of Railroad Model Craftsman, what he should call his new line of scale cars.
He said, well, why don't you use your own? It's just a good name. So Weaver was born.
Weaver brought out his first engine in 1986. It was a two-rail, O-gauge scale RS3.
So now we have our first engine's born, and this is a smashing success. This is unbelievable.
In the late 80s, the surge in the toy train market was fueled by a huge increase in the number of operators, guys who wanted to build layouts and run trains. And the trend in layouts was towards realism. A market for high-rail, scale locomotives was created. In 1986, Weaver decided to enter that market. He tried unsuccessfully to modify his scale RS3 so it would negotiate the sharp 15-inch radius curves frequently used in high rail. The narrow body would not permit the can motor adequate movement. Weaver's second locomotive, an Alco FA2, introduced in 1990, was able to handle the short radius curves.
Now our FAs run on the 15-inch radius track. You've got a wider body, you've got more room inside for the tower to move and get all the turning motion that you need to get around the tighter radius curves.
Weaver entered into an agreement with Samhongsa Trains Limited to produce model trains under the Weaver Models name. A Korean company, Samhongsa, has a reputation for manufacturing high-quality scale and high-rail model trains. The first model Samhongsa produced for Weaver was a fine model of the Pennsylvania Railroad's Mountain M1A locomotive. It was introduced in the fall of 1990. Other brass models quickly followed. They included the UP-FEF-3, the Nickel Plate Rhodes Berkshire, Pensy's T1 Duplex, and the legendary GG1. Samhongsa also made a handsome model of General Motors E8 diesel in plastic. Short-run stamping dies made of brass made it possible for companies like Weaver, Right of Way, K-Line, and Williams to make highly detailed engines in low quantities, sometimes as few as 500. The cost of these short-run stamping dies is about one-tenth the cost of a die used to make die-cast engines.
They've got lots of ideas. They've been in business a long time. They've made a lot of HO engines. If they come up with something they think might sell, that really, you know, would be good in their gauge, we talk back and forth. After we decide on an engine, they have the plans over there for every engine ever made in the United States. So they send us the plans, we okay, we circle certain things we want, certain things we can live without. The two things. In other words, is there enough detail on the engine to warrant the price?
Weaver credits his straightforward approach in dealing for his successful business relationship with Samhongsa.
I don't argue with him. You give me, I ask you, or I give you an engine that I might want to do. You quote me a price. If I can live with the price, I won't haggle whatsoever, but I want a quality product when I get it. And I want the detail that belongs on it. We commit to Samhongsa X number of pieces. Now we're guessing at that. You get your color catalog made up then, and put your, now our color catalog with the G5, and what's coming in 92, right, is gonna be in the color catalog. Then we mail those out to everybody by the thousands. Now it's up to us to sell these things. We've already put down payments on all these.
So far, sales have soared.
Sold an enormous amount of engines, I'll phrase it that way. Our business has quadrupled in the last 3 years.
Weaver trains are sold through 15 distributors, and there are no plans to add on any more.
So I bring on 5 or 10 more, right? That's going to delete some of their sales. Because there's only so many people out there going to buy engines. I'd much rather bring in 500 engines and sell them than bring in 700 engines and have 300 of them left.
Weaver has big plans for the future.
Well, we've got a GP38-2 started, which is going to be a brand new engine in about a year. I've got cars that I want to make. I've got buildings I want to make. I'm not going to live long enough to do all this. That's why I say I've got my grandson. My son-in-law is my right arm now. But my grandson is there. He's my, I've got him brainwashed. He's going to be a die maker. He's going to learn to make his own dies.
What about the recession?
It's affected us some. But the thing that scares me, if the economy picks up, right, I'm out of business because I can't keep up to it now.
Bruce Lawrence started with a small American Flyer S-gauge layout.
I had two trains when I was a kid, and I used to play with them all the time, all the time. So I came on back home and found the old trains and took them back out. And after that, it just kind of snowballed.
After building a nice 6x9 layout, Bruce wanted to expand into the adjoining family room.
What I wanted to really do is I wanted to try to get two trains running around the whole family room, or should I say train room now, since that it kind of like took over most of it.
Bruce didn't stop at the family room.
So I kind of like asked my wife Sheila, and we kind of agreed that we could expand into the laundry room. So we did some modification with the plumbing and everything, and the rest of it turned out pretty good.
So what we have here is a layout which started on a 6x9 plywood table, then expanded out along the wall of the family room, over the side entrance stairs, to an oil field above the Lazy Boy, over a Gilbert Erector bridge on the mantle above the fireplace, past the industrial area next to the bookcase, through a tunnel into the laundry room, past the dryer, workbench, and washing machine, through another tunnel, over a permanent bridge which has to be ducked under each time you enter or leave the laundry room, and back to the original layout. We think Sheila is a very understanding wife.
A very most understanding wife. Back in 1978, I was by my friend's house, and I saw his old Flyer trains, and I think I started getting the bug right then to start collecting and operating the old trains I had when I was a kid. I'm pretty much loyal to Flyer right now. Nothing beats good old two-rail track. That's the way trains supposed to be run. I got a lot of friends that are Lionel collectors and operators. I don't know. We all have our own fun, okay? That's the main thing. I'll stay out of that one.
Both Lionel and American Flyer made operating milk cars. While similar in appearance, the cars differ in a number of ways. American Flyer's milkman is black. Lionel's, cream. Lionel has one opening on each side. American Flyer, two. And on the Lionel car, the cans are loaded through an opening on the roof. You load the Flyer car by opening a door and dropping the cans down a ramp. But in spite of these differences, both cars have one thing in common: erratic performance.
I told you, this is a flawless operation. No problem at all.
Other Flyer accessories include the oil drum loader, featuring Louie the Loader.
That's what they call it, good old Gabe the lamplighter. He's the guy that climbs up the ladder and turns on that light and he goes back down. It has, in the last few years, become a very, very desirable accessory. Lately, I've been seeing some of the Gabes going from $700 up to $1,000. You are paying for the rarity and also the quality, too. But I have mine on the layout. I don't want to see it in the box because then I'm not going to have any fun with it.
Bruce wanted to build a toy train layout like those built in the 50s.
I got plywood, homosote, plus the roadbed, and it makes a very quiet layout, and you could hear the choo-choo. And you gotta hear the choo-choo.
His goal was
to have fun with some toy trains. And I enjoy it because you're always building something all the time. I have more fun building it than actually operating it, but operating is still a lot of fun too. And a lot of times we'll get a lot of guys over here and we just have a ball all day long. And I just say, guys, take it away, go have some fun. And I'll sit back and watch, and it's really nice. They'll bring some trains to run too, because a lot of guys don't have a layout and they don't have any place to run it. So I said, bring it over here and we'll do it here. And let's see what happens.
The trains operate at the same speed, whether next to the transformer or 30 feet away. Bruce attributes this to good connections and the use of feeder wires.
Make sure that your connections are really good with all your track. And what I've done is to make pretty much a good run of layout is solder the wires to the track and have feeders every few feet so you never lose any power.
Bruce's collection is displayed on the walls in the train room and on both sides of the partition, which separates the train room and the family room.
I like the trains from the very late 40s to the middle to late 50s, right around there, because that's what I really remember when I was a kid. Anything old that Flyer made is fine with me. I do enjoy steamers the most, though. Passenger trains are okay, but steamers with smoke and choo-choo is the way to go. But sometimes you gotta be an adult to have all the toys that you wanted to have when you were a kid. You never have all the toys that you want to have, okay? But what I have right now, I think it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun.
All this started 12 years ago. Now Sheila and Bruce have two boys, and they are eyeing dad's space for things like ping pong tables and air hockey.
I've had to lay out up since I built the layout starting in 1979, so it's been an easy 12 years plus that it's been up. And I think it's time for me to take it down, and I have to give a little bit more to my two boys and the wife. So we're gonna put the trains away for a few years, and then someday they're coming back out.
Exclusive release from Antique and Classic Trains is the Union Pacific MP15 engine and matching caboose in new full prototype Union Pacific colors. This means custom UP details not previously available from K-Line. Today's collector demands the best, and full perimeter red pinstripe over UP yellow, painted gray frame and handrails, plus gray power truck side frames is prototype railroading. But a matching red pinstripe caboose with die-cast trucks, metal brake wheel, and illuminated interior makes this matched UP set collector's choice. Now, until March 15th, you can order the Union Pacific twin-motor MP15 engine and classic caboose for only $149.95, plus shipping and handling.
Great layouts, great track. Gargraves.
The area around Strasburg, Pennsylvania, in the heart of the Pennsylvania Dutch country, offers many attractions for the estimated 2 million people who visit there each year. But probably no place has a greater appeal, especially for children and train enthusiasts, than the Choo Choo Barn in Strasbourg. Here, thousands each summer are entertained by a tiny world of trains and animated vignettes. It's a miniature land of fantasy and fun, with plenty of living history thrown in. The fun starts when you walk in the back room of the Strasbourg train shop, which is where the Choo Choo Barn is located. There are two levels of O-gauge trains running throughout. Tom Groff, who owns the Choo Choo Barn, says sometimes people are reluctant to take the tour.
And invariably the wife will say, oh honey, you take the kids in to see the trains. And the husband will take the three kids in to see the trains, and within seconds he'll be back out through the curtain and saying, honey, you have to see these trains. There's no way, you have to see this display. He'll pay the money, and they'll all go in. And of course, the wife is always the last one to come out. She doesn't want to come out, and everybody else is out in the gift shop waiting. In Thanksgiving Day of 1961, my father opened up the Choo Choo Barn with approximately a 500 square foot display with six animations and six trains. And the whole reason for opening the Choo Choo Barn in 1961 was to help defray the costs of my brother's college education. Well, over the next 29 years now, we have gone from 500 square feet, we're now to 1,700 square feet. We now run 13 trains simultaneously, and we're up to over 135 different animated figures and vehicles. It's just a never-ending job to continually update the display, continually keep it operating, and make it better every year.
The first vignette you might linger on is a baseball game, being played like thousands at summer fields around the country. Here, a runner takes a lead off third base. Is he breaking for home? Is he going back? You decide. There is some construction near the baseball diamond with steamrollers in action. There's an army camp and a zoo, which has an HO gauge touring train, the better to view all the wild animals. Above the zoo is a snow-topped mountain with a ski run and skating rink. The start of the run is reached by means of a beautifully modeled cable car, suspended high above a railroad and highway. Along this stretch is the transportation hub of the layout. Here, kids can stand and watch for a long time and come back again and again for more looks. Adults, too. Many of the scenes on the layout have roots in the Amish Pennsylvania Dutch area. An Amish man plows with a two-horse team. They move around the field as tirelessly as those sturdy, hard-working people do in real life. A group of Amish build a barn. Barn building is a community effort with the Amish, who always pitch in to help a neighbor. This splendid model, one of the highlights of the layout, has a total of 34 men working, while women and children look on. The Dutch Wonderland is an accurate facsimile of the real thing, a local tourist attraction. It includes an encircling monorail, which is in HO gauge. The river at the Dutch Wonderland flows into an aquarium in a corner of the room. The aquarium is low to the ground, where children can get a good look at the fish. Another highlight of the layout is the Christie Lee Circus. There is lots of action here. Lots of rides, including a big Ferris wheel. The most death-defying stunt at the circus is a man balancing on a 100-foot wire by his nose. He swooshes back and forth, almost to the point of complete annihilation. But he never wipes out, though, and the circus continues on its merry way day after day. Around the corner from the circus, a farmer holds a rifle at the ready, waiting for a groundhog to peep out of a nearby hole. The hog appears. The farmer raises his rifle, but he always misses. Behind the groundhog is a children's park. And nearby, another barn under construction. Kids here swing and teeter-totter. Up from the barn is a town in the midst of a Memorial Day celebration. The holidays at the Choo Choo Barn are all warm weather ones. That's the season when most of the 2 million visitors come to the Strasbourg area. The highlight of the celebration in town is the parade. On the road that heads up to the parade is an 8-horse team of Clydesdales pulling a red wagon. One of the big thrills of the Choo Choo Barn tour is the fire. At regular intervals, it breaks out in an A-frame house. Uh-oh, you can see it over there. Smoke. Smoke is coming from the roof of the A-frame. Now it has burst into fire. The smoke is heavier. There goes the fire alarm. The fire truck comes out of the station. Traintown Volunteer Fire Company number 1. The truck rushes to the scene. The smell permeates the area while a fire truck continues to push toward the flames. It stops. It pours water on. The fire is struck. The house has been saved to await another calamity 20 minutes later. A familiar sight in the Strasbourg area is the Amish plugging along the back roads in horse-drawn buggies. Near a stream is a Boy Scout camp where the good deeders are working for merit badges. One day, these little tykes will no doubt be full-fledged Eagle Scouts. They won't work any harder, though, than these 4 Amish men who are cutting wood for winter heat, just as they really do in life. They saw and chop as untiringly as lumberjacks. Our tour of the Choo Choo Barn is almost over, and we are at the President's Place. This is a pantheon of former United States presidents through Jimmy Carter, with a place for Ronald Reagan. 40 presidents standing together, forming a select group, one of the most exclusive and prestigious in the history of Western civilization. In front of the presidents, Old Glory blowing in a constant wind. Behind them, a park, a band show, and musicians playing. The music plays, and so do the children. Nearby is the baseball game. Americans on the 4th of July. With the presidents there, what a 4th of July that would be. And at the Choo Choo Barn, that's the way it is. The stars and stripes forever. The 4th of July, that never ends.
Memories of the old Lionel showroom layout in New York City, which opened in 1949, still fuel the enthusiasm of toy train buffs today. But that was then, this is now. This is the Lionel showroom layout for the 1990s. It's part of a new visitor center in the Lionel Administration Building located just off I-94 in Mount Clements, Michigan. Tours of the new facility are open to the public by appointment. Stay tuned and Toy Train Review will give you a preview. The first stop on the tour is a fast-paced 10-minute video. It starts at the beginning when Joshua Lionel Cowan first opened shop in 1900 and moves quickly through some of the bad times and some of the boom times to the present, with Lionel firmly established as the largest toy train manufacturer in the United States. The video also gives you a peek inside the factory and shows how Lionel trains are made. The magic begins when you exit the theater and enter the 24 by 52 foot showroom. The layout is a 14 by 40 foot rectangle. You enter facing north, about halfway down the 40 foot side of the display. The Lionel History Wall is in front of you, the control panel to your right, along with a 4 foot high mountain. Seven trains operate simultaneously on various levels throughout. Two trains, a Lionel large-scale Northern Jeep and the standard gauge Blue Comet, travel along a plexiglass shelf just below the ceiling. There is even a train running on a small circle of track beneath, appropriately, a Christmas tree. The first part of the layout you see is the yard area. There is a turntable and three-bay roundhouse, one of three scenes which evoke memories of the 1949 layout. The three main lines feature a GG1-led Amtrak passenger train, a freight headed by a New York Central Mohawk, and the irrepressible Santa Fe F3. They leave the yard together, heading east towards the entrance to the tunnel, which runs through the mountain. Exiting the mountain, they sweep north, past the new Lionel lift bridge, then west down the long stretch in front of the Wall of History. Here the tracks turn in towards the center of the layout. This allows unobstructed views of the various accessories and cars parked on sidings closer to the edge. About one-third of the way down, the Amtrak descends to the lower level, or as the Lionel people refer to it, the subway. The Santa Fe and Mohawk continue west, then turn south towards the Lionel City Station. The Amtrak, now on the subway line, reaches the area first. This vignette is similar to the famous tri-level scene which greeted visitors who entered the New York showroom. The Mohawk continues south, then turns east for the stretch run back to the yard, where it is joined by the GG1 as it emerges from the subway. The Mohawk rumbles through the yard, continuing east towards the mountain and another trip around the layout. The fourth train on the main level is powered by a red and white Frisco GP7. It also heads east and disappears into the mountain under a Lionel girder bridge. The Frisco emerges on the other side and travels a route west below the plateau which runs the entire length of the layout. At the north end, it enters another tunnel and emerges on the other side in the yard area. Ten inches above the main level, a Chessie SD40 freight exits the yard heading west towards a small urban area. Past crossing gates, it makes a U-turn around the far end of the layout above the Lionel City Station. Then back east towards the Lionel Mountain. Into a tunnel. And out the other side, over the Lionel Girder Bridge, and onto a rocky ledge above the yard. The third area reminiscent of the old Lionel showroom layout is the top level. On the old layout, the electronic set used to travel along a track pattern which was shaped like a dog bone. Layout builders call this type of track pattern, not surprisingly, a dog bone. In the new layout, an American Flyer Missouri Pacific PA Alco pulling four streamlined passenger cars travels a similar path. The smaller S-gauge train, speeding along past trees and rock formations, 18 inches above the rest of the layout, gives the impression it's farther away than it really is. Using smaller trains on the upper levels to create the illusion of greater distance is called forced perspective. The new Lionel layout effectively uses this technique. Notice how the larger O-gauge trains appear to be closer. In addition to the Amtrak train, two Lackawanna MU cars operate in the subway. They are visible only at the cutout area and through a plexiglass window located just below the south end of the yard. The gateman and strobe light add a nice touch. Josh Cowan once said, "Children want movement and action. They just don't want to watch a train go round and round. A few minutes of that and the little nippers will wander off and squeeze out some toothpaste or set fire to the curtains." The new Lionel layout offers plenty of action and audience participation too. Over 50 buttons, which activate accessories, are placed at various points around the layout. Each button is labeled to indicate the accessory it operates. Thank you. The 52-foot-long, 8-foot-high north wall is filled with trains, ads, photographs, catalogs, and other memorabilia depicting 90 years of Lionel history. The story begins with a blow-up of Joshua Cowan looking the way he must have looked in 1900 when he opened shop with the idea of making electrical novelties. They call this the Wall of Lionel History. We think it's more like a Wall of Lionel Memories. When you look at this room, the layout, all the lights, Lionel trains running from the floor to the ceiling amidst the sounds of steam whistles and diesel horns, you can't help but wonder what Joshua Lionel Cowan might have thought. We think he would have been happy and proud. In the next issue of Toy Train Review, we'll tell you how the layout came to be. We'll show the original foam core mock-up, the early plans, table construction, how the layout was wired, and methods used in scenicking. Don't miss it. Special thanks to Sandy Bestie, Lionel's manager of advertising and promotion, who did a fine job of operating the layout for us.
That's a gorgeous ring, Sam.
Thank you.
The Toy Train Review brings a new concept to the toy train hobby. It is a 60-minute video quarterly devoted to every aspect of tin plating. Four times a year, in the spring, summer, fall, and winter, you will receive a complete program about toy trains. Nothing about the hobby is ignored in the Toy Train Review. No story is too big or too small to escape the probing, entertaining style of producers James Toohey and Tom McComas, whose previous work has made them the toast of toy train videos. The Toy Train Review is the start of something historic, and now is your opportunity to be part of it. Become a subscriber on a yearly basis and save money, and be eligible for special offers. Or buy the Toy Train Review separately as each issue comes out. The Toy Train Review. Subscribe now and say you were there at the beginning.
From the great Atlantic Ocean to the wide Pacific shore, from the green and growing mountain to the South Belt by the shore.